We just heard the story about a man blind from birth who spent his life and all of his days as a beggar sitting at the side of the road. On one particular day, there's suddenly a massive crowd of people pushing and shoving and trying to get around him. Unable to see, he starts asking people, "What's going on?" And he realizes that Jesus is walking through the streets of his town. Now, the blind man's heard about this Jesus. He's the one that people say can heal the blind. And the man's heart begins to pound almost out of his chest with excitement. If it's true, he must be thinking, the desire of my heart for my entire life has been that I would be able to see, and here's my chance right now. And he jumps to his feet and he starts screaming, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Immediately, the people in the crowd tell the blind man to shut up, to go away. Tell him to not create a scene, to leave Jesus alone. They didn't want Jesus to be annoyed. Or maybe, more honestly, they didn't want to be annoyed by this blind man. Well, as the story continues and the blind man is healed by Jesus, he's confronted by the religious people of his day, the leaders, the ones who saw themselves as clean and good and righteous. And they would not believe or accept this man's healing or his encounter with Jesus. And one must ask themselves why. Well, maybe it's just our human nature. We try to shut people up, to push people aside who interrupt our comfort, who mess with our routine, who make us question our own perspectives of life. We'd much rather have people shut up than say disturbing things about genuine faith. A local pastor friend of mine recently shared with me a situation that happened to him a few weeks ago. He told me about a brief conversation he had with a woman when she was leaving church one Sunday. And my friend told me that this lady emerged from church saying to him at the door as she left, "I know that you would not intentionally hurt anyone with what you say from the pulpit, but I was hurt by what you said in your sermon today." My friend said, I thought to myself, where have you gotten the notion that I would not want to hurt you? I'm a preacher. Some infliction of pain comes with the job. Luther compared the word of God to a surgeon's scalpel. In the Gospel of Luke, the 4th chapter, it says Jesus went to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom, and he stood up and read from the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. As it was handed to him, he unrolled it. He found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, and to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Jesus quotes from the prophet Isaiah, and it stands as a constant warning to we who are preachers and all of us who are followers of Jesus. It all has to do not so much with our words, but with the word of God. A word that is a call to action. A call that is an invitation to us and to others. And sometimes this work invites us into interruptions of our comfort zone. It is intruding into our comfortable routines and our cozy facades. A word not of our own making. To be the ones who hear and receive that word is sometimes challenging and sometimes painful. As Luther said, here is a word that first kills in order to make alive, that damns in order to bless. Writer Victoria Lores, co-founder of the Wild Church Network, believes religion's true purpose is to restore our relationships with each other and the earth. She points out that many churches don't like surprises and are especially not fond of any spirituality that threatens the equilibrium and the way things have always been done. People don't like or want their spirituality to be messy. So what happens is we end up pretending that our life and our way of seeing the world is completely in order, that it's sacred and righteous, even though it may be quite a distance from how Jesus invites each of us to live and to love. We think to ourselves, don't mess with my religion or my faith. Don't challenge me too much to see the world through a different lens. Because what we've created here is comfortable and familiar, and it's a religion that works for me. The word religion at its root means re, again, and legios, connection, like ligaments. Religion is meant to offer support to connect again what has been separated. Connecting us to God, connecting us to each other. Apparently, we need constant reminders to continually reconnect with the fullness of life, the whole and the holy. So much of the time, what people have created in the religious sphere of life is more like disligion than religion, or a disconnection from people who are not like us. When religion loses its purpose and joins with those who would try to divide and keep others out instead of bringing them in, it becomes irrelevant and even irreverent. I was recently talking to a young 23-year-old woman who let me know that she wasn't opposed to believing in God, but she didn't see or experience a God of love in the religion of her parents. It is pretty normal for people to want safety and security. And many of us crave environments and messages that comfort us. And there is a time and a place for that kind of comfort. Sometimes the Word of God, the love of the body of Christ, is like a salve for our souls and our hearts. It can lift us up. It can hold us close to the very heart of God. And that is an important part of God's good news to each and every one of us. But the good news must be extended beyond ourselves, extending beyond our comfort. Extending to others is sometimes challenging for us, asking of us some sense of sacrifice on some level. Many people inside the church don't actually want to be challenged. They only want to be comforted. But the role of the body of Christ is to do both. It is to comfort those who are broken so that they will know who they are and whose they are. They will know that they are loved beyond measure, a precious, loved child of God, created in the image of this loving and compassionate God. And here is the reality. Every single one of us needs that message. And when we encounter that transformative truth, it can lift us from our fears and open us to be challenged so we can bring that love, that grace to others. But the reality of messy lives, messy faith, messy spirituality, it strikes fear into the hearts of we who are comfortable, we who are sometimes unwilling to just look in the mirror. According to the comfortable, God does what God always does. God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, which we often want to interpret as that God stays the same. And there are those in churches who honestly believe that God is just a nice and neat God. And if you just take a quick survey of the various characters in the Bible, we realize just how messy all of their lives were. And sometimes those messes are caused by their own doing, their stubbornness, their selfishness, their fear, their small-mindedness, or even their cruelty. Other times, their lives were messy by no wrongdoing of their own. Yeah, it sounds a lot like us, doesn't it? And our lives. Sometimes messy by our own doing, and sometimes messy by no wrongdoing of our own. Well, the God of the Bible is filled with surprises over and over. God is finding ways to offer surprising comfort to the uncomfortable, and often making life uncomfortable for those who are smugly, maybe even arrogantly comfortable. Those who simply want to package God neatly into their life, those who want and expect God to do exactly what they want God to do. But God doesn't just show up in the Bible or in our life in a neat little package with a bow on top. No, God shows up as you look through the Bible in so many ways, sometimes in frightening clouds of smoke and fire, in earthquakes and windstorms and firestorms, in donkeys that talk and pillars of salt, oceans splitting apart, God showing up using a little boy to kill a giant, a Messiah born into poverty, a God who sees how frightened we are, who sees how broken we are, and loves us into something new, and then tells us to love others the same way. No one could truly follow God and stay smugly comfortable for very long. Mike Iaconelli, the author of Messy Spirituality, the book that we're using for the themes of this sermon, talks about an attractive young woman on the fast track toward a lucrative business career. She decided she wanted to take a little break and delay her career plans in order to work with some inner city young people. God had been working in her heart and she felt the sense of calling. And so she was hired by this church where there was a pretty good ethnic mix that was taking place. And within weeks, she was out in the community working with gang members. She successfully convinced a few of the gang members to attend a Bible study at the church. And one night she was talking about Matthew 6:33, but seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. She explained that if you want to be a follower of Jesus, a disciple of Jesus, nothing can be more important than Jesus. And her words were, if the gang is more important than Jesus, then the gang has to go. If your girlfriend's more important than Jesus, then the girlfriend has to go. And one of the gang members was so into what she was saying that after hearing those words, he reacted violently by throwing his arms back, yelling, "Dude, it's hard to be a disciple." And as he did that, his elbow crashed through a window. Well, when the church found out, they were very upset that they had to pay $26 to fix the window. And they restricted the gang members from using that room any longer. Here was a young woman teaching gang members about Jesus, and they were listening. She was doing such a good job that her students understood how costly faith was. What a teacher. But all the church could think about was the broken window. But it got worse. A few weeks later, the pastor accidentally interrupted one of the Bible studies. And he sat down and spent a few minutes talking with the gang members. And after he left, one of the gang members said, "Hey, I like that guy. Let's go to this church on Sunday." So the youth worker decided to seat them in the balcony rather than with the congregation downstairs. And when the minister came out and announced the sharing of the peace, one of the gang members spontaneously stood up and yelled, "Hey, dude, you're cool!" And the congregation turned around in shock. And after the service, the youth worker was told never to bring the gang members back to the church until they learned how to behave properly. The church should have turned around and invited the gang members downstairs. They should have applauded this woman who was doing an amazing job reaching out to these young men. Instead, the youth worker was fired. Apparently, this church was more concerned about comfort than it was about a group of gang members, discomforting their search for spirituality. Seek the spiritual life. Admit our own messiness. Follow Christ wherever he leads us. And discomfort is right around the corner. According to Jesus' critics, Jesus did God all wrong. He went to the wrong places. He said the wrong things. He healed on the Sabbath. And worst of all, Jesus would let anyone into the kingdom. Jesus scandalized an intimidating elitist country club religion of his day by opening membership in the spiritual life to those who had previously been denied it. And what made people furious was Jesus' irresponsible habit of throwing open the doors of his love to the whosoevers, the just anyones, and the not a chancers. Actually inviting the likes of you and me. Seems that one of the things that makes some church-going people pretty angry is actually grace. Oh, not the grace that's given to us personally, but the grace that's now being offered to those who we still deem to be outsiders. Somehow, once on the inside of grace, it's pretty easy to think that our new job is to now be the gatekeepers, keeping out those that we deem not worthy. Think about the irony, even the hypocrisy of this. Truth is, we're all equal in the sight of God, loved and created in the image of this loving God. And each and every one of us who's created by God is seen by God as part of God's wonderful creation that is not just good, but is very good. And admittedly, we may be rough around the edges, and we're all a little bit and at times a lot broken. And because sin is a part of our world and part of our own lives, we know that not one of us is truly worthy of the grace bestowed on us by God, but it's given. And we're invited to the party. And we realize that there's a place at the table for us. And so we begin to enjoy the party, and suddenly we realize that there's some unworthy people who have stumbled upon the party too. But too often we find ourselves, the ones who've already received the grace, standing at the door, making sure that certain unworthies don't get in. Maybe it's because they're not enough like us, or maybe it's because they remind us of who we are also. Maybe this messy and strange phenomena occurs because we think we should somehow make grace more respectable, more responsible, by becoming self-appointed kingdom monitors, guarding the kingdom of God, keeping the riffraff out, which I if I understand it correctly, are who the kingdom of God is supposed to include. And when this happens, we've forgotten our purpose. We have forgotten who we are and whose we are. And I believe that must break God's heart. Which is more uncomfortable? And which is more life-giving? Keeping the riffraff out? Or as the prophet Isaiah shares, to proclaim the good news to the poor, proclaim freedom to the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, and the setting the oppressed free. The truth is, we all need bigger, grace-filled hearts. We need to ask God to free us from the limitations of just our perspective, just our life narratives, and the prejudices of our own heritage, and the insecurities of our own comfort zones. We need to be genuinely grace givers and freed from the insincere niceness in our need to be right. Together, let's make sure that we put down the judge's gavel and we take up the servant's towel. Amen.